Do you think the president obstructed justice?
Yes, I do. It's very clear that the president obstructed justice.
There's no one that could factually say there's not plenty of evidence of collaboration or communications between Trump Organization and Russians.
I think there is direct evidence in the emails from the Russians through their intermediary offering dirt on Hillary Clinton as part of what is described in writing as the Russian government effort to help elect Donald Trump.
Interesting stuff. There you have some Democrats still clinging to their collusion theory despite the lack of evidence that we know of so far.
But they say there's plenty of evidence. Joining us right now, a guy who knows a lot about evidence, contributor Trey Gowdy. Trey, are you surprised that we're just supposed to assume that there is collusion? They just talk in assumptive phrases that we everybody knows it's collusion and there was some type of simpatico working relationship there.
Yeah, if you listen to Adam Schiff and Mark Warner over the weekend, the brand new conspiracy or collusion evidence they have, the brand new thing they have is an email from 2 years ago. An email, and Brian, keep this in mind, an email from the manager of a pop singer no one's ever heard of in Russia to Donald Trump Jr. And what I wish you would do at some point today, put up that email string. Put up the email between Rob Goldstone and Donald Trump Jr., and you will see phrases like official documents and information. You will see incriminate Hillary Clinton and her dealings with Russia. Nothing about emails from WikiLeaks, nothing about Podesta, nothing about the hack of the DNC. She was the Secretary of State, she was a U.S. Senator, and she was the First Lady. So if she had dealings with Russia, I would think we would already have that on our side. I would think that you would not need to get that from Russia. The other point is this. If getting negative information from Russia is tantamount to a crime, then whoever dealt with Christopher Steele needs to go hire a lawyer.
or whoever accepted that foundation money, the Clinton Foundation money from Russia. They got all that money. Whoever took the $700,000 speaking fee from Russia, that's Bill Clinton.
Yeah, Trey, you know, Cohen is expected to testify before the House Intel Committee in a closed-door session this week. I don't anticipate them finding any new information. Maybe you'll see less grandstanding because it's closed door. What do you think happens next with this?
Well, I think what we learned this past week is just how utterly useless public congressional hearings are, and this notion that you can unlock important information in five-minute increments. I think the two closed-door sessions this past week on the Senate and the House side with the intelligence committees were very helpful. I think that's why they're bringing Cohen back, and I think good Republican members like John Ratcliffe are going to get Cohen to distinguish the Trump he described in his book transcript versus the one he described before Congress. And I think they're going to go through every sentence Cohen uttered the last time he was before Congress in 2017 so we can get a better idea of just how many lies he told and how many Mueller let him plead to versus how many he actually committed. The closed-door hearings are actually constructive. You get an hour to ask questions as opposed to 5 minutes. Look, Cohen is not being used as a witness by the Southern District of New York. He's not being used by a witness as a witness by Mueller, but yet Congress thinks he's good enough to not only use as a witness but kick off their case against President Trump.
So, Mr. Gowdy, are you suggesting that Congress is less interested in getting to the bottom of it and more interested in just making Donald Trump look bad over the next 2 years until Election Day?
Well, let me ask you this. What serious finder of fact can you name that identifies information in five-minute increments and does it on television and then flip from one side to the other? I mean, the grand jury doesn't do it, your local sheriff doesn't do it, your United States attorney doesn't do it.
Well, you've tried to do it. You've tried to do it in the past.
And I was an utter unmitigated failure, which is why in the one investigation I ran, we interviewed 103 people. 102 of them were done behind closed doors. Yeah. Only one was done publicly, and that didn't go very well.
Well, Trey, I got to ask you, I can't make heads or tails of this. The Southern District of New York was emphatic that Cohen was not a cooperating witness. Yet he refused to answer some of the questions because he says it was an ongoing investigation. So no one followed up with a question you probably would have asked and said, by the way, are you cooperating with the Southern District of New York? What do you read from this?
Well, the Southern District of New York is way too smart to use a witness like Michael Cohen. I mean, can you imagine him in front of a jury? I mean, how many weeks would you need to set aside to just go through the prior inconsistent statements he's made? So no good prosecutor would ever use Michael Cohen. Can he point them to other evidence? Maybe, but look at the check. I can think of two really good reasons to not want your spouse to find out about hush money payments. One is the preservation of your marriage. The other may be political, but what happened with John Edwards? The facts in the John Edwards case were much better, and a jury said not guilty. So if that's what they're going after in New York, good luck.
Right. I just can't believe that they're allowed to go after the way he financed different opportunities. They were able to go after Deutsche Bank, his tax returns, Felix Sater, his CFO, his sons,
everything,
his daughter. They're all going to be called up. Why is that allowed?
Well, Congress, as a co-equal branch of government, can ask for whatever they want to ask for. Now, it doesn't mean you have to show up, and it doesn't mean you have to talk, and it doesn't mean you have to produce documents. I mean, we have three branches of government. There's tension that was built into the system. Nadler, remember when Nadler and Schiff didn't want to interfere with ongoing investigations?
Right.
Does anybody remember that?
Yep, good point.
They no longer have that concern. So this is all about 2020. And they can ask for it, but the president's got really smart lawyers, and I'd be shocked if they produced it.
The problem is, though, that if you don't show up, the media paints the narrative as you're trying to hide something. So unfortunately, the position the president's in, it's like he can't win no matter what.
Well, the media is going to do that regardless. You just played a clip of Jerry Nadler saying the president committed a crime.
Yep.
Did you hear that crackerjack reporter follow up with a, okay, list all the evidence. Who's your first witness? I mean, who's the first witness you're going to call in an obstruction of justice case for the firing of Jim Comey? Are you going to call all the Democrats in 2016 who thought he should be fired? Is that going to be your witness list?
Great point. The big question is, does America want to watch for the next 18 months a Trump investigation without winding up with some sort of Trump investigation fatigue? And that could come back to backfire on the Democrats.
We'll never get Trey Gowdy fatigue.
Lose a few Republicans in the Senate. All you need is 51 to get it out of the Senate. So to pass the House, with a handful of Republican votes, it'll come to the Senate. It might get 51. It'll get vetoed by the president, and Republicans will stand with the president to sustain his veto, and it will be deader than dead.
All right, that was South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham last week with me right here on Sunday Morning Future, sharing his prediction on the fate of a Democratic House resolution intended to block President Trump's national emergency declaration to build a border wall. The Senate will soon consider the measure after it passed the House last week. Some Republicans are signaling their support over concerns a future Democratic president could also choose to go the national emergency route to bypass Congress. That's why they're pushing back on this. Joining me right now in an exclusive interview is Florida Republican Senator Rick Scott. He sits on the Senate Homeland and Governmental Affairs and Armed Services Committees. And Senator, it's good to have you this morning. How are you going to vote in that measure?
Well, I'm going to vote for border security. I'm going to vote with the president. Everybody that's going to vote on this ought to go down to the border like I did. Talk to Border Patrol, and here's what they're going to tell you. One, they need more people. Two, they need new technology. The technology they've got is decades old. And three, they've got to have barriers just so they have operational control. So if you go talk to them, there is no way you could then say, oh, I'm going to vote against border security. The Democrats don't want border security. The American public wants border security. They want results. I know a lot of people don't like the process. None of us like this process. It's all caused because the Democrats don't believe in border security. I want results. I know the president wants results.
All right. So what about your colleagues who say the reason that I have to push back and not vote with the president is because a Democratic president in the future might take advantage of the same thing? I mean, this has been used, what, 60 times, calling a national emergency?
Right. Well, look, a lot of people can come up with a rationale for voting against things. I think the American public, they want results. The president tried. Look, he's tried to get the Democrats to fund the border. He offered things. He said, let's talk about DACA. Let's talk about fixing the TPS program. And they said, no way. They did everything they could to make sure there was no border security. So the president's doing what he has to do to take care of the American public, which believes in having a secure border. And I'm going to vote with the president. And I hope every Republican, I hope the Democrats will take the time go to the border, and once they do, they have one choice. Either vote for border security or go tell border security that you don't care about their safety, and you're telling Americans you don't care about their safety. It's a simple choice, in my opinion.
Well, what about your colleagues on the Republican side that are going against the president? Why aren't your colleagues firmly behind this president then?
I think people are, you know, they want to say that, oh, this is not the right process. And I agree. It's not the right process. I mean, nobody wants this to be the process we go through. Why are we here? Because Washington is completely dysfunctional. Washington doesn't work. I've been there about 2 months. It doesn't work. But the Democrats will not fund what Americans want. Americans want border security. The president's doing his job. Secure the border.
When you say Washington doesn't work, is that because that too many people in the Congress have their own ideologies and they're not doing what their constituents really want them to do?
I think there's a bunch of actors. Look at the Democrats. They'll go give a talk about border security, and then they'll vote against it. I mean, there's just a lot of actors up there. We've got to get people that, one, I believe in term limits, as an example. We've got to get new people up there that are just absolutely committed to getting something done. We shouldn't pay people if you shut down government, if you don't pass a budget. That's your job. I mean, there's some basic things that I'm a business guy.
Right.
And so in business, you try to get things accomplished.
Let me ask you this. The bill is going to come to the Senate floor when? What's the timing on this? When do you expect to vote?
We're not sure exactly when we're going to vote on it. I think it's still another couple weeks at least that's going to come. It's got to come. I think it's got to come to Armed Services first.
Yeah.
And then we have 15 days. So I think it's at least two more weeks.
Meanwhile, the president just back from Hanoi with his meeting with Kim Jong-un. Your reaction to that? The president talks a lot about his relationship with Kim Jong-un, but we are yet to see any real movement in terms of denuclearization.
Well, first off, you know, let's remember, he's a dictator. Kim Jong-un's a dictator. He's a thug. He's a murderer. That's what he is. Now, I think the president's doing the right thing by trying to figure out how we make our country safer, by sitting down with him and saying, you need to denuclearize, and this is why your country, you and your citizens will be in a better position. Now, in business, you know that you have to walk away from deals a lot. That's the way what happens. Often before you get a deal, you have to walk away from it. I think the president did the right thing. He walked away because he is not getting what he wanted out of the deal. And I'm proud of him for doing that.
Yeah, but what can we expect on this issue?
Well, you know, what you hope for is that North Korea comes to their senses and says, look, I want to have freedom and democracy. I want to have our citizens with plenty of food. I want to have them great jobs. That's what you'd hope.
Yeah.
But we have to remember this guy's a tyrant. He's a thug. He murders his own citizens, his own family. So you have to have low expectations.
All right. We will leave it there. Senator, it's good to see you this morning. Thanks so much.
Nice seeing you.
Senator Rick Scott joining us there.